Hi everyone, Ezekiel O'Callaghan with Raptor Chatter here, here to talk about all of the finds for paleontology that happened in May 2019. Amber comes from trees, and some of the Burmese amber in particular has been great at capturing the life that lived during the time it was created during the Cretaceous period. With a number of geckos, birds, and very, very unique arthropods being found in this Burmese amber. However, now there's a piece of this amber that's been shown to have an ammonite and a few types of marine snail in it. The finding of these marine animals in the Burmese amber helps to show how this amber formed in an area that had fairly large tides and a lot of water being brought in from the coast and being incorporated into the soil and into the areas where the tree sap would run and eventually harden into amber. Additionally, with the ammonite being a Pusosia ammonite, it helps us narrow down the time range that the amber formed, being between 110 and about 95 million years ago, very much in the dead center of the Cretaceous period. Archaeopteryx is the best known fossil coming from the Solnhofen limestone. However, one of these Archaeopteryx fossils was found not to be an Archaeopteryx, but a new genus called Ostromia. Now, there's another fossil of Archaeopteryx that may not be an Archaeopteryx. Elkmanavis poschli was thought to have been an Archaeopteryx, but may be a separate genus. The wings of this bird were slightly more robust than those of the other Archaeopteryx specimens we have, and so may mean that it is its own species, separate from the Archaeopteryx that we've previously known. This find indicates that flight in birds may have already been well-developed by the time of the Middle Jurassic, when we find Archaeopteryx, and that the first birds and flying dinosaurs may have started even further back than we had previously thought. There are still some questions, though, about whether Alcmenavis isn't just an Archaeopteryx, because while these wings do seem larger and slightly different than those of Archaeopteryx, it is a very fragmentary fossil, and so there is still some debate as to whether or not Alcmenavis isn't just a particularly large individual of Archaeopteryx. Keeping on the subject of flight, we're going to look at Caudipteryx, which had long flight-like feathers, but definitely couldn't fly. Its wings were just too small to be able to lift it into the air. However, that doesn't mean that they couldn't have provided some lift while the animal was running. In order to test this, scientists looked at the most similar body plan of living animals to Caudipteryx, which is a juvenile ostrich. From there, they used modeled Caudipteryx wings and attached them to the back of the ostrich, and had the ostrich run. With complex sensors, they were able to test the G-forces and the amount of force and lift that was generated by holding the wings outwards. What the researchers found was not only that the small wings did provide decent lift, but they also formed a pseudo-flapping motion, with just the natural currents of air going by, causing them to lift and fall, and lift and fall, very much like a flapping motion. This could help us understand where flight in the birds first came from, as there have been two main hypotheses for where it came from. One hypothesis was from the trees down, with a few small dinosaurs hopping from branch to branch and using their feathers and wings to help glide further distances between them. And the other being from the ground up, being that some of the dinosaurs, while running, would use their wings to help them accelerate faster, or balance, or help cause some lift while trying to climb up steep slopes. This evidence from Caudipteryx, the most primitive dinosaur having long flight feathers that we know of, helps to indicate that the ground up may be a more likely scenario for developing flight in the birds. When North and South America finally collided, there was an event known as the Great American Biotic Exchange, where animals from North America and South America migrated to each other's continents. One of the most important places for understanding this event is the Yucatan in southern Mexico, where many of these species from both continents interacted. Fossils from underwater caves dating to about 35,000 years ago have helped to show how many of these species began to interact and migrate between the two continents. Fossils from these caves include things like giant ground sloths, but also Arctotherium, a bear that was even larger than our modern-day bears. There's also the canid Protocyon and a few human remains found in some of these caves. Knowing that humans were able to reach these caves without going underwater thousands of years ago should be somewhat alarming, as continued climate change is going to alter the environments, and not necessarily in ways in which humans are adapted for them. And so we need to be prepared to deal with climate change in a real and meaningful way. Many types of fish, from the very small sardines to some varieties of shark, have schooling behavior and form shoals at certain times. However, it's incredibly hard to show that schooling behavior in fish appeared anywhere in the fossil record. And that's because oftentimes, even when many fish die, they aren't going to form the same kind of formation that they would have in life. A new fossil coming from the Green River Formation has shown, though, to preserve this behavior. This densely knit ball of over 250 fish helps to show that there was communication happening between different individuals of the species as far back as the Eocene, over 50 million years ago. This kind of behavioral communication between individuals of a species wasn't thought to have been preserved in the fossil record. And while we don't know exactly how this fossil that is very unique was formed, it does help us lead into questions of what we might be able to tell from other fossils in the future. The Megaraptorians are some of my favorite dinosaurs, and not because they're incredibly unique, but rather because they don't seem to fit in anywhere as far as we can tell just yet. Many fossils of Megaraptorians are very fragmentary, and new species that are being found still have this trait of being fragmentary, and so it's hard to narrow down where exactly on the theropod line they lay, whether they be closer to things like Tyrannosaurus or things like Allosaurus, which, while superficially similar, are very different and took very unique paths in evolution. New fossils coming from Thailand help to indicate that they may be closer related to things like Tyrannosaurus, laying on the Saurosaur line of the theropod family tree. Buyangvanator yamniomi is a new Megaraptorian, and Veuraptor nongbualumpuensis is a newly found basal Saurosaur. Together, these two species help to illustrate the variety of theropods that were living during the early Cretaceous, with Megaraptorians being found throughout much of Eastern Asia, Australia, and South America. However, they did start to decline during the late Cretaceous. I earlier mentioned that many of the Megaraptorians are very fragmentary in their remains, and the same holds true for Fu Vuyangvanator, as it is also very partial, and so more fossils of Megaraptorians need to be found before we can definitively define which clade they do truly belong in. The petrified forest is known for trees, but that's not the only thing that's found there. Among the fossils that are found there are a few very early dinosaurs, the crocodile-like phytosaurs, and massive amphibians known as metoposaurs. The most common metoposaur from the petrified forest is Koskinonodon perfecta. However, as it turns out, that may not be a valid name for the fossils coming out of the petrified forest. Before the metoposaurs were discovered in the petrified forest, a fossil came out of Wyoming and was called Anachisma. This Anachisma may be the same species as the fossils coming from the petrified forest. However, Anachisma was very fragmentary, whereas the fossils coming from the petrified forest of Koskinonodon were almost perfect, lending to the scientific name perfecta. And so, after almost 100 years, it turns out that Koskinonodon may not be Koskinonodon, but rather it may be Anachisma. And that just highlights how we need to go back and look at all of the formerly found fossils and ensure that we aren't doubling up on the number of species we found so that we can get a much better picture of what exactly lies in front of us so that we can better understand how to address extinctions and biology in the future. And finally, coming from New Mexico, my neighboring state, we have Suskityrannus hazelae. This tyrannosaur was fairly small, as the fossils we have of it are juveniles, but it is the earliest tyrannosaur to show the arctometatarsalian foot condition, which is a special adaptation in the foot of a few different types of dinosaur, which helps them run longer distances. It's been found in tyrannosaurs and also in things like the ornithomimosaurs, like Gallimimus. The initial discovery of the fossils took place in 1998, meaning there's been over 20 years of research done on these fossils in order to formally describe them. That doesn't mean that they weren't totally unknown, though. The documentary Planet Dinosaur used an animal based off of these fossils to create Zunityrannus in their film. However, we do now know that Zunityrannus is more accurately Suskityrannus. Hi everyone, thanks for watching. Lots of stuff came out in May. I'm moving, so the next time I film one of these month in reviews, I will probably not be standing in this same corner. My next video is probably gonna be me packing up all the rocks and going through some of them while I do that. But, you know, be safe, take care, don't go extinct.